Hello everyone, and welcome for the last talk of this morning's session. Cyril Brulbois will present us news from the Debian installer, so please welcome him.
Thank you, bonjour à tous. So I'm going to divide this talk in mainly two parts. The first one will be some kind of retrospective of what happened during the stretch release cycle, and then we'll focus on what is currently happening for the buster cycle and what is planned, what we are trying to smooth out for the next release. So let's begin with stretch. That's not the first time I'm giving this kind of talk, and usually I compare the release cycle to the previous one. For GSE, we had one alpha, two beta release, and three release candidates before the actual GSE release. It was already much better than what we had for Wheezy, which had fewer releases. The timing wasn't that good at the time, but we felt there was some kind of room for earlier releases and more releases. I mean, once the release cycle is started, it's not too good to wait a few months until you release a first alpha, because there are so many changes piling up, and when something breaks, you cannot test anything because everything changed from the past release. So for stretch, that was really much better because we managed to squeeze 8 alpha releases between July 2015 and November 2016. So the distinction between alpha and beta was really artificial. That was just a name. So we simplified these bits and only called those alphas, and then release candidates when we are reaching something that shouldn't move too much. Especially when the freeze starts, we are calling the DI releases release candidates, because we are not supposed to do that many changes at this point. Of course, that's what should happen in an ideal world, but there are so many breakages and last minute changes that we need to squeeze in every time. So that's why we had 5 release candidates between January and June. And yes, we did some release candidates just a few days before the actual stretch release, because there were still some moving parts, even if we don't like that, but hey, that's life. Let's concentrate on installation images. One of the big changes is that the full CD sets are gone. You must ask why, but then I've got numbers. We had up to 80 CDs, like for MD64. On the last build in 2015, we had 854 images, which piled up to several hundred gigabytes for each DI release. So times 6 and now 13. So that's a big storage space that wasn't really useful, because we don't have any stats for downloads, but you can imagine that if you need that on CDs, maybe DVDs are a better bet. And it seems that we are moving towards more network mirrors, and you only usually need a few packages which are on the first CD or the first DVD, and we don't need that anymore. We had some really scary stats as far as building goes. We already had 12 to 24 hours delays between a release and the publication of the installation images, which breaks the momentum a bit, because hey, look, it's released, but you cannot install it because we don't have the installation images yet. So right now the only CD option is netinst, so a network based install, which is not a netboot. Netboot is for booting for Pixie, so that's a different thing. And we kept a single extra CD with whole desktop available, which is XFCE, For all the others, you can select the desktop you want to install directly from the installer, since Jesse, I guess. Previously, you had to type some boot options to obtain this or that desktop. So now that it's easy, we only focus on that single CD. On the port side, MIPS64EL was added and PowerPC was retired because nobody was maintaining it, and so it beat us a bit. For unofficial ports, we are now having some more machinery to allow for breeding against the Debian ports archive, which makes the testing and installing easier for people working on ports. So that doesn't change anything for the official Arch, but that should help them a bit. We had some change on the multi-arch image, so AMD64 and Intel in 32 bits mode. We are now defaulting to 64 bits, which is yay, except it's 2017, so it's about time. We managed to do that with some SysLinux trick. We have a small module which we can use to select AMD64 when it's available on your CPU, otherwise we default to 32 bits. So Didier took part, dealt with that change. Another default change, you might be aware of Wendell Monroe's XKCD, and there's a famous strip for people familiar with the Debian Boot IRC channel, which is this one. When globally, you would be asked to configure your system and select some hostname, which is apparently a bit more upsetting than choosing your daughter's first name. But basically, we're familiar with that blue screen and gray and red, and that's about it. But now we switch the default and we are installing with the graphical installer by default. I mean, it's been many years, like 12. It was first released in 2005 with Edge, but it was only a technology preview. But it remained this way until this release, because we never flipped the switch. We can call that resistance to change, or just lack of opportunity, or we didn't think about it until it was too late. That's what happened to Jesse. So finally, at the very beginning of the Twitch release cycle, we flipped the switch and we're now getting the graphical installer by default. What is it about? Basically, the AI is driving devconf and prompting you for answers and presenting you with choices. And basically, the text installer and the graphical installer are working really the same, except we can do more things with the graphical installer. Especially with translations, we have many languages which are either not available in text mode because of missing fonts, or it's not possible to render them, or not render them properly. And we can have a few interesting things, like with Hebrew, which we are going to see on some screenshots right after that. So that's Hebrew with a text mode installer, so that's a right-to-left language, but it's displayed on the other way around, the progress bar is going the wrong way. So that's with the text installer, and with the graphical installer, everything gets back in the right direction. I mean, for them, because they... We can have some better rendering, like, for example, here, Persian. I'm really not into languages. I mean, I speak some bit of German and that's about it. But you might think that, okay, maybe we can understand which glyphs and which characters are displayed here, but they are only individual characters. There's no ligature or liaison or whatever that's called. It's only character next to each other. And now we're getting proper rendering with GTK. Everything is smooth and you get letters combining with others and so on. If you know more about those languages, feel free to educate me so that I can give a better talk next time. We've got Punjabi. Punjabi is not available at all for the text in Solr. It's not about a better rendering. It's just not possible to display this language in the text in Solr. It's a bit of a shame because there are like 100 million people talking this language. It's a bit of a shame not to display it. So with the graphical installer, we can finally reach more people. And that's the same with many languages in India. Small languages have millions of people. So it's not really French and Canadian French and so on. It's a bit on a larger scale. There's also Sinhala, which is another language from Asia, I guess. So how does this work? We're using GTK for the rendering parts. Previously, that was working on DirectFB, but that technology was retired and deprecated and with many bugs. So a long, long time ago, it was proposed to switch it from DirectFB to Xorg. And somebody called for help because the graphical installer was never released officially. And it was already on the way out, even with all those maybe not marvelous but interesting features. So I knew nothing about installer, I knew nothing about the DirectFB or Xorg. So I joined Debian Boot at this time. And basically, in 1 week, I had some kind of a working proof of concept. If you're interested in details, everything is on my blog. There are 4 blog posts, so it's quite easy and quick to read. And that's basically the reason why I then maintain X within Debian for a few years. Basically, the one to blame is Julien, who said, oh, you're a grown-up, so please commit your patches and please join the team and tag your it. I'm going to do release work. So thanks, Julien. That was really interesting to get that kind of a chance to join the team. And a few years after that, we had nobody left working on the release management part of the Debian installer. So, hey, you know something about Debian installer, don't you? Yeah. So please go maintain it. So that's why I've been having a step in the release team and in the DI team for a few years now. The other person I would like to thank again is Jocelyn, who is the person who called for help in 2010. So everything started because of him, and I'm really happy that it turned out this way. I'm going to talk a bit more about fonts. We had a big change in the CGK world. CGK for Chinese, Japanese, and Korean. That's a group of languages with similar problematic around rendering, fonts, combinings, and so on. So before we had an interesting package, so TTF for true type fonts, CGK, so easy and compact, because we were extracting many fonts, one for Chinese, one for Japanese, one for Korean, and then we were extracting from those fonts, which are a bit huge, only the glyphs we needed for the Debian installer. So we needed to have the list of all glyphs, so all characters we needed to render, and then extract every rendering, every images from the font, and then combine it into a single package which would be smaller than what we had before. And of course, translations evolve. You've got characters disappearing, others appearing, and in the end, you've got query images and everything is broken. So thankfully, I guess Fonts Android is a Google font, primarily targeting phones and so on, but it's also available in Debian, and we used its UDEB, so its micro Debian package, to get a better coverage of all characters we needed. And we're no longer playing the game, I'm going to extract a few bits and then everything breaks every few days or weeks. So, fragility is gone, no missing glyphs, so everything is good, right? Right? If you look at the screen, you might notice what is happening, because that's the selected entry. We have Korean with squares, so that shouldn't happen because we've got the whole package with everything inside. So what is happening? Maybe a few characters are missing? No, if you pick Korean, everything is broken again, because hey, that's a package, it has updates, and sometimes the updates are broken and so on. So we need to keep an eye on what is happening with the rendering, especially for non-Latin fonts, but also for Latin fonts as well. And once the package was updated to use a different font file, we've got proper rendering in Korean. I mean proper, it looks better. I'm not sure it's correct, but it's definitely better. On the upward side, we had Juliet get selected again for a new artwork, which is Soft Waves. She was already selected with the Lines artwork for Jesse. On the integration side of things, we've got Desktop Base, which is a common package for all desktop environments with lock screens, wallpapers, and everything. And for Beginning Solo, that's WordScale GTK, which is of course used for the GTK part. We've got the banner at the top of the screen shown in all during the whole installation process, but also bootloader parts with greetings and so on. I'm getting back to that a bit later. So if you didn't install Stretch or upgrade to it, well, that's the default wallpaper, a lock screen, and I'm going to talk about networking. We got a proposal quite early in the release cycle to switch to another kind of way to name interfaces. So some people disagree because it was pushed by systemd people or whatever, I don't really care. All I care about is that the installer system was still using the old naming, so ETH0, while the install system was using ENF3, which is a bit annoying if you configured the install system with the old name. So thankfully that was caught during testing, I guess for Alpha 1, yeah. And Martin Pitt and Michael or Michael Bieber were kind enough to provide with fixes, and that was a near miss on the releasing side. But hey, that's an alpha, that's what it's for. So then I'm going to talk a bit about priority. Basically, when you install Debian, you get task cell, so you select the task that you want to install, which are basically meta packages to install desktop or everything related to French or to English, like dictionaries and so on. But we've got a set of basic packages, which are picked based on their priority. So you can have required packages or optional packages, etc. So Ansgar proposed to remove quite a bunch of all packages from the important or required set, so that the images would be smaller. That's the case for installation of bare metal, in shoots, in containers, in VMs, and so on. So maybe you are going to lack this specific daemon that you've been expecting and using for years, maybe dozens of years. But basically, we are reducing a bit the minimal footprint of Debian installation. At that point, it seemed that maybe we could have some fun with the init system, what is systemd going to be installed anyway, and so on. And everything was prepared with the init system helpers, I guess, package. And we had nothing to change on the Debian installer side. Everything was handled by the FTP masters, who are the final reviewers of the actual priority that we put into packages. Then we've got HTTPS support added. We had to get a way to actually talk HTTPS. That was done by creating a new UDEV for the wget package. Before that, we were using the BusyBox wget. I'm going to get back to that in the second part. And we had to trust, I mean, trust, it's HTTPS, so we have the CA mafia and so on. But we have to trust a bit the other side, so we have an extra UDEP for CA certificates. So Marga and Philip pushed for this, I seem to remember, because Google was interested in getting more HTTPS and less HTTP. But we had to adjust some bits, because even if you force HTTPS installation, depending on the installation image you would use, you would be missing apt transport HTTPS or CA certificates in the installed system. So we had to fix some images to make that actually working. But a question remains: how do we trust HTTPS mirrors? How are we getting our mirror system to work with private keys and so on? So that's not a huge issue, but it's not entirely transparent. You cannot just flip the switch from HTTP to HTTPS on any mirrors yet. Some work needs to happen on this side. So that's it for Stretch. That's a really short presentation, because there were so many more changes, there are so many people to thank about it. Sometimes I'm identified like the DI guy. No, there are dozens of people pushing many patches, so that's only a very a very quick overview of what happened during those 2 years. So let's look at Buster now. Unfortunately, we've got some to-do work which is carried over from release to release, especially SecureBoot. Right now, it's not possible to install Debian when SecureBoot is enabled. And that's a shame, it's been the case for way too many releases. And we need user to actually disable it, which means setting some kind of root password for the BIOS, no UEFI, and then disable it, and then maybe unset the password because you're going to forget it. So it's a bit of a heavy process. The solution is known for quite a while. I guess the plan was already outlined in 2014 in Cambridge Mini DevConf. So we already have signing keys for SecureBoot. We need to update the infrastructure to actually use them, and that's the heavy part, because we've got FTP master and some packages need signing, and we don't want the key to be stored just as a file, so we need some kind of crypto tokens. And there are so many moving parts and so many teams involved that it's not there yet. I'm not going to throw rocks at anyone, it's just not happening yet, which is sad. But hopefully, at some point, that's going to be a... Yeah? Mike?
Section Tuesday.
Section is Tuesday?
Yeah.
Okay. And once everything has happened, maybe we'll need to adjust the eye a bit, but probably not. It's just about getting the actual packages signed, and everything should just fall into place. So maybe we'll be able to backport part of it for Stretch, just by picking a few packages and adapting a few things. So maybe through some kind of point release, we could have the official casual images and some testing ones with SecureBoot enabled, and see if that works well. But well, we'll see. On the GTK side, we've been lagging a bit because we are still using GTK 2, while GTK 3 has been first released a few years ago already. I actually had patches for it in as soon as May 2013, but we needed to introduce new UDEPs. So libgtk in the 3 variants needed Cairo object, and then we discovered that we were missing the ATSPI bridge, and then libepoxy. What is libepoxy? It's basically a wrapper for Mesa functions. So then we were, with everything in place, every packages having UDEP and so on, we were failing at runtime because we were missing Mesa, which is a huge library, and we definitely don't need any 3D inside the eye yet. I mean, you're not going to play any games at this point. I'm glad I found so many new contributors. And fortunately, this issue with LibGS being mandatory just went away a bit before Stretch was released. It was expected to look into it during the Stretch release cycle, so it's going to have to wait until Buster. So we need to clean up the patch series, that shouldn't be hard, but we need to port or maybe rework how the artwork is integrated, like how to highlight in this or that color, how to set the background colors and so on. So maybe write some JavaScript, and I don't want to know yet. Another thing also for the graphical installer, we are using default input modules, so FDev for everything like keyboard, mouse and so on, and separate components, so keyboard and mouse for FreeBSD and Herd. And we should be able to use at some point libinput, which is kind of a merge or a new way to handle keyboard, mouse, touchpads, which have been quite a pain in a DI context. They were not working during the installation, but they were working once the system was installed. So hopefully everything should fall into place with this this new way of configuring inputs in DI. Then we've got some booting improvements suggested by Steve. At this point we are using Grub or maybe SysLinux or IO Linux, you can call it either way. And the plan was to get rid of everything and just focus on Grub, which should reduce the surface of bugs and maybe make it maintenance easier. So Steve will be working on this, right? Talking a bit with others who didn't want me to prepare these slides, I came up with a few interesting suggestions, like speeding up the installation process. We have many file system options. You can disable some safety stuff, like disable barriers, or maybe set some write-back stuff, and so on. But I'm not a kernel developer, I'm not a file system expert, I don't want to become one, because life is too short. So, the big issue is that these options can speed things up, but also alter data safety. Maybe you are going to write stuff in the wrong order, or not save it the proper way, and so on. So the proposal is to use those file system options which are really making stuff speedier, but only during the installation process within the installer context, and you just forget about these options when you boot the actual system. So that shouldn't be too hard from a safety point of view, while still allowing for the speedups. So here's an example which I'm told is working fine for a big electricity supplier somewhere in Europe. So data write back and some asynchronous stuff and no barrier. And the suggestion came from Raphael, so you can draw any conclusion from it. I'm leaning towards pushing for LVM a bit more, because there were many objections, so there's no need to address that through questions at the end of the talk. We've got a thread going on the Debian boot mailing list, so if you want to voice in or out of it, that should happen there. From my point of view, LVM makes it easier for people to actually change partition size afterwards, because once you've got the DOS or GPT set up, it's a bit trickier to reduce some file system or augment that other one. The root file system would be too small, and when that happens, it's a bit a mess to actually make it larger. Maybe you've got to move some directories and then bind them, or it's really tricky. So that's just an idea. Feel free to follow. Another one is speeding up the debug swap phase. Basically, on Intel hardware, it's going fast enough for casual use. But once you've got some ARM device to set up, it's a bit lengthier. Like you take one coffee, and then 10, and then it's still not finished. So we could maybe stop looking into the available packages, and then computing dependencies, and then fetching packages one by one, and maybe failing, and then everything breaks, and you've got to start over. And maybe just pack everything together in maybe some kind of tarball, and then download that, and then install from it. It might not be perfect, but I guess it could be an option that some people could use to speed things up. So we could benefit from it in the installer for cloud images, because people building cloud images are also running debug swap. And when you build custom images, I don't know, for some customers you may want to build a device based on Debian and not actually run DI on it, but just copy root partition over. And we could benefit from it in various areas. So this was inspired by Aurélien. And I said that I was going to get back to BusyBox. What is BusyBox? It's a tiny set of tools for Unix. You see here everything that we use from BusyBox in a DI context. So many, many basic commands are available there. Unfortunately, we are lacking a maintainer within Debian. It's been the case for at least one release cycle, which is really way too much. And apparently, Upstream is active and friendly and responds positively to bug reports and enhancement suggestions. So it would be nice if the collective you would follow up on the request for help that I opened a few months or maybe years ago. We have a component which is called OS Prober, which is trying to probe for operating system, looking into devices, disks, partitions, and so on, so as to detect which other system might be installed, so that it can feed the list of extra entries to the bootloader. So you can boot your Microsoft system, or Fedora, or whatever. The problem is that probing should be like, I'm looking into it, is there this or that, okay, I'm doing this and that. But the current, or at least the previous code for probing was having some kind of side effect, like corrupting file systems, which is not too good. If you had some kind of virtual machine, you could corrupt stuff on the host, which is really bad, because you can then pollute other VMs. So there were many really critical bugs on OS Prober. Colin is looking into a 2.0 version of it. He wants to make it testable, because every time we wanted to fix a bug, we would break another thing, or it would slightly change another output, and so on. So testing is important. On an implementation level, he wanted to make it declarative, so instead of having way too many shell scripts and fragments calling each other and then taking sometimes up to minutes on a real modern hardware, that's really a pain at the moment. So make it declarative so that it's easy to write detection code, but also quicker by not using so many fragmented shell script parts, and just having some C core configured with these declarative statements. So if you want to learn more about it, he posted some detailed plan, so that's out OS Prober 2.0 again on the Debian boot mailing list. Speaking of testing, we are currently relying on actual people, which is great, but a bit a huge work. That's the metrics of everything that many people tested on release day, or night, or was it day? I don't remember because it was lengthy.
It was both.
It was both, yeah. Several times around, I guess. So it's really, really great that we have so many people testing actual insulation images and finding bugs so that we know and user can know that this image cannot install this and that combination in this and that order and so on. But we are already past the point. We already released Stretch. We copied our stuff on FTP master, and then we built installation images. And if there's anything to fix, it's already too late. We can just document what works and what doesn't work. So the idea is to actually test stuff in advance. And basically, I'm usually, when uploading Debian Installer, the source package, I'm doing a build and then testing in QEMU or libvirt a few things like basic installation, next, and then, oh, but you've got to type passwords and user, and it's really boring. I mean, really. Really. So I wanted to script that. I knew that Phil had been working on some kind of automated testing stuff and so on. I honestly didn't see any summary and so on, and I was like, I know exactly what I want to do because it's exactly what I'm doing right now for a few years. So I wrote a tiny tool, nicknamed Kedit because no imagination and so on. And basically, it's driving the installer through X11 events. So you start QEMU or libvirt, and you just select a playbook which says, I want to make sure that this screenshot is shown, and then I press this key, and then I want to make sure that this screenshot is shown, or this, or that one, and then I do this or that. And that makes it way easier to actually test images because you've got automation. Even if I'm really aware and only focusing on some installation process, it would take up to 10 or maybe 15 minutes to go through everything. With this tool, I got installation under 3 minutes, so you can test a lot of stuff and in some kind of automated fashion. At this point, it's not integrated into check-in, it's not run automatically, but I really would like to make that a reality, to actually make it easier to spot regressions, because right now I'm finding them when I'm about to upload a new release. So we've got some minutes left, so I'm going to try some demo because hey. So I spoke about Japanese, so maybe we can do some short demo with Japanese. So with that's a netboot image with GTK, and I want the Japanese version. So it loaded a playbook, which is a textual description of every step we need to undertake. We've got a few screenshots which are expected at each step. And once the screenshot has been obtained, we then respond by typing some keys and so on. So it's going a bit quick because it's polling, it's taking screenshots quite regularly, and once the wanted image is shown, it just types and confirms the screen, and it's going on and on and on. I'm not going to do the whole installation process because it's a netboot image, so everything is going to be fetched from the network and it's going to take time. So I'm going to just kill this one and start a different one, like LVM. So maybe you saw the selected entry go down and up, just to make sure that it's not totally broken, because we had sys-linux fun quite a few times already. And then this time it's a whole CD, so every component should be already available except for packages which are only stored on security. And as you see, there's no need to actually interact with it. So the HTTP is going to work directly. I'm typing autotest, which is nice because it tests whether AZERTY and QWERTY are working fine, which is not always the case. And then we reach the partner menu, and then we are switching from the top entry to the middle entry so as to enable LVM. So the installation is going on. I'm going to show you what the playbook looks like. On the left, we have a basic install with several screenshots which are possible. So ISO Linux, higher menu, I386, and some unofficial stuff. Because depending on the image you're using, whether it's official, not official, and with some late changes as to how the menu is shown, we can have either of the four screenshots here. And you see that in response, we are sending the down and up and return that we saw on the first screen. Then we are writing on the language screen. I set an extra key to make it possible to accept some kind of diff between the wanted image and the one we got, because the scroll bar on the right of the screen is not exactly the same every time. Like when you fix Korean, it was broken with squares, and then it's shown properly, but a few pixels off, so it breaks. So you've got to tolerate some differences. For example, when you use EFI and not traditional QEMU, you've got some slight wandering differences, like a few pixels with a few red or blue changing. So we've got to accept some differences, but not too much, because you don't want to accept any screen anyway. So we've got some 20-25 steps with some input like the name, the passwords, and so on you want to set. And it's a bit boring to obtain this, so I wrote a tiny script to record what I was doing so that it can be replayed afterwards. And once you've got the basics, you can then inherit from the basic install, so that's LVM on the right, and it's the whole file for LVM. And I'm just changing partner menu to insert to change return, which is accepting the default, to I want the next entry and then return. Of course, we have a few differences in the next screenshots, so there are some other stuff to change, and we've got to confirm LVM is set up as we wanted. So there are some change, removed or added steps compared to the basic installation. So in the meanwhile, the screen wasn't rendered, so the screenshot was failing, but then it resumed when I switched back the focus on it. And then everything is broken because I shouldn't have switched from one desktop to another. But hopefully with Xefire, XVFB, and some other technologies to decouple the rendering and your actual work, it should be possible to see what is happening, but then not disrupt everything. So, live demo and example playbooks were shown. We need more playbook, so I need to document and then show a bit more what we can do with it. It needs to be integrated into Jenkins or whatever system to actually get test run and reported. Because, for example, we have shoot, installation, and upgrade tests for tasks like desktop, XFCE, GNOME, and so on. But they've been working in May and June, right before the release. We didn't notice. Thankfully, there was some kind of BSP, and one guy said, oh, VLC is broken, and everything falls down. But we need to be more proactive, and running tests is good, but checking the results is better. So we need to do something. And this kind of tool needs to be integrated with that kind of with that kind of things in mind. So I'm going just to show you the slide and not really talk about it, so that you have some tips and tricks if your package ships a UDET, it's going to be used usually in the Debian installer. So if you change your packaging and that affects the UDET, we really would appreciate if you talk to us, so Debian boot before doing your change. You can contact me directly because I don't follow everything going on the mailing list. And that's basically about it. If you found a bug affecting the Debian installer in some other package, please put Debian boot in copy of your report so that we know about your issues. And that's about it. Thank you.
So I'm afraid we are out of time for real life questions. There was one question on IRC about this automated testing stuff. Do you have any plans for doing testing on actual hardware and controlling that remotely?
Not at this point. I guess we would need some kind of robot to actually input stuff in some keyboard or doing stuff over a serial console, and then you're not actually testing the interaction through the keyboard and so on. You're testing installation over a serial console, but maybe Steve would.
Yeah, exactly. So in Lenovo and Lava, we have been doing some testing or installation or whatever, and I think, you know, on real hardware, that is exactly the problem. Actually picking up on a real installer, not just the one on the serial console, is much, much harder to do.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
So, I just remembered the thing that I couldn't remember when you asked me yesterday. We were going to do regular backport builds, if you remember.
Yeah.
We spoke about it last summer, and I told you, well, between us, we ran out of time to make it happen. I would love to get us having a regular backports build every couple of months.
We just need to get around to actually do it, but
Help would be wonderful, people.
Thank you.